Greetings, our Hebrew Israelite brothers and sisters. This is L.D. Smith, the watchman on the wall. Israel, it is our Sabbath. I grab that King James. But first and foremost, we want to wish all of our sisters and brothers all over happy Sabbath. That being said, we're going to go forward into our teaching tonight. We have a wonderful teaching. There have been a lot of chatter, you know, going over the internet and over the airways about different ones saying that they are black, and others saying that they are black, that are white. And we want to clear up some of that, you know, because our identity have been stolen from us by the white man. Now our identity is being stolen by the white man's children. Yeah, and see, I'm tired of it, you know. We have people that are of color that doesn't really understand what is black and what is not. And let me explain something, you know, before I get into our teaching. Just because one have color in their skin and doesn't mean that you're Hebrew. I mean, Joseph was in Egypt, and we know that when Joseph's father died, all the Egyptians went to the funeral, and the people of that coast said that, what a great host of Egyptians. But we all know that Joseph and his family was down there with them. So that let us know that all of them were black. That being said, just because one say that they have color and that they are black and that they're Hebrew, and that can be further from the truth. And I mean it, you know, from the bottom of my heart. Just because one have color in the skin, that doesn't mean that you are Hebrew. Being Hebrew, you have to have the bloodline. You have to be pure. I mean, if you're not pure, then you are not the original. I mean, so for one to stress that, well, I'm black and I'm Hebrew, well, that could be further from the truth, my sisters and brothers. I mean, God knows his people. And as I said in other teachings, and I'm going to say it again in this one right here, you know, Amos 9 proves it. But let's look at something else. Remember when Moses was in Egypt? And Moses was named by the Pharaoh's daughter. Huh? Yes. Did God call him a Hebrew name? No. He called him Moses. You know why? Because if God had called him anything else, Moses wouldn't know who in the hell he was talking to. See, so just because one has color in their skin, you can't claim that you're Hebrew. You can't. If your bloodline is tainted, then you're not Hebrew. Straight up. I mean, that was an old thing said back in the country, and it still reverberates in my mind even today. They will see one that didn't belong and didn't look like us, and their word would be that all the elders would be sitting on the porch, and they'll be conversating back and forth with one another, and they would say, you know, to one another, something in the milk ain't clean, huh? And that's exactly what is going on today. But yet and still, we want to invite everyone into the black community as being black, and they're not. Now, Raven Simone, she made a statement, and then everybody want to jump on her, but the white girl played this game for I don't know how long, working for the NAACP, and she just, you know, kind of tan up a little bit, you know what I mean, and say, well, I'm black. Then the truth comes out, and then these so-called blacks, well, okay, she have done so much for the black community. She is black. Now, how stupid can one be? Why would one accept the lie, know that it's a lie, and accept it, and then say, well, okay, well, it's okay? I mean, I don't understand. But yet, instead, Raven Simone tells them that I'm a dark-skinned white woman, or white lady, whichever one that you guys may want to take. Then everybody want to jump on her. Why? She looks nothing like me. If you want to round off a number to the nearest number, as they do here in America, their general math, on a scale from 1 to 10, she's one shade lighter than a white person, but 50 shades, huh? She's one shade darker than a white person, but then 50 shades lighter than I am, and y'all want to call her black. That doesn't make sense to me at all. How in the hell can she be black? She's not black. And I'm tired of all of Master's children stealing our identity. They are not black. And for all you that don't know the real story, if you read Amos 9, well, let's go there. Let's read Amos 9. Let's go there. See, because you need to see with your own eyes. See, God is going to separate like he did before. He's going to do it again. See, so whether you believe it, whether that person over there believes it, or whether you don't believe it, that still doesn't change God's word. So really, it doesn't matter what you believe when it comes down to the Most High. But check this out. Amos 9:9, it says, for lo, I will command and I will sift the house of Israel, no one else, huh? Among all nations, like as corn is sifted in a sieve, yet shall not the least grain fall unto the earth. Now, anyone is familiar with a sieve, how it operates, it separates that which looks like the real thing, but it's not the real thing. See, so there is no slipping in. If your bloodline is tainted, you're not Hebrew, simple as that. I mean, I don't give a damn whether you believe it or not. God's word says that you're not Hebrew. So you can try, you can want, you can dance, you can do whatever you want to do. But it's not going to change God's word. Now, another thing too, what is going around, they're asking for the black man his nuts. I mean, and offer him $35,000 for his sack. Now, my sisters and brothers, it seems like to me something should be wrong with that. It seems like a red flag should go up. Why would they want something that is nothing? Supposedly now, something that is lower than low, but yet still you want his reproductive organs. That doesn't make any sense to me at all. Apparently, you got the story wrong. You want the royal nuts. That's what you want. You want to try to go in and try to recreate and try to be like God. But it's not going to help you. It's not going to help you at all. Now, let's go into our lesson. Because we need to see how serious God is about mixing and mingling his seed. Now, we're going to come from the book of Ezra, Ezra 9. Now, look what it says here. We're going to read Ezra 9 here. We're probably going to read all of it, I believe. Let's start. It said, now, when these things were done, the princes came to me, saying, the people of Israel and the priests and the Levites, now look at it now, have not separated themselves from the people of the land, doing according to their abomination. See, other nations were doing things that were an abomination to God. Now he's saying here, separation. God does not want his people mingle up with all these other nations. I don't give a damn what nobody says right in the pages. I mean, you can get mad, you can be glad, you can be sad. I mean, really, I don't care. But it's right in the pages. I'm not going to sugarcoat it because, know why? We hear a lot of menumber.org. We're going to tell you the truth. We're not going to dance around the truth. We're going to tell you exactly what thus said the Most High. Now, look what he says here. He goes on down here. And he starts with the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Perizzites, the Jebusites, the Amorites, the Moabites, and the Egyptians, and the Ammonites. He says, for they have taken of their daughters for themselves and for their sons, so that the holy seed have been mingled themselves with the people of those lands. See that? I mean, how in the hell can you guys not understand what he's saying here? He's saying that you should not mingle the seed, because it is an abomination. I mean, if you dissect the word abomination, that means that, what is a bomb? A bomb's destroyers. This is my philosophy on it. A nation. So what you're doing is you are destroying two nations. When you mingle your seed together, it is no longer the original. But some say, oh, well, we're going to make a pretty baby. Okay, make that pretty baby. God is not going to accept it. And God is not going to accept it. You can cry, you can weep, you can do all that bullshit. God is not going to accept anything but the original. Now look what he says. He said, for they have taken of them daughters, verse 2. And he says here, for themselves, with the people of those lands, yea, they had the head of the prince and the rulers has been chief in this trespass. God, this is a trespass for you to mingle your seed, for you to go outside your race, for you to have sex with anything other than your own. God doesn't like that. Now, I know a lot of people say, well, we're in America. I don't give a damn. That don't change what God says. That does not change what God says. God says he want a pure bloodline. That's what he want. That's what he's going to get. Now, if you've been mingled up, I mean, look, God had to do it. Okay? If you mingle up with something else, God had to do it. You know, because he abhorred. He said that he abhorred those men that with strange women, strange flesh. But let's go a little further here. We're going to read on down now. He says, look at verse 3, say, and when I heard this thing, I rent my garment and my mantle and plucked off the hair of my head and of my beard and sat down astonished. This man, he pulled all the hair out of his beard here, pulled the hair out of his head. He's there saying, what in the hell was they thinking about? I can't believe that he's bumfounded, he's bewildered, he is surprised, he is all messed up. Y'all got me messed up here. I can't believe you guys have done this. I mean, he is a stone. I mean, he is, oh, how could they do something so damn stupid? But yet it's still today, we're in America, we're in a melting pot. And anyone knows, when you throwing this in and throwing that in, it's like sludge. That's what it is. It's nothing but sludge. Just like they do down in New Orleans. Well, we got gumbo. And, oh, they love that. They eat that bullshit up. They throw in every shellfish they could find out of the water. And then top it off with some damn sausage. And they just eat up. Oh, boy, I'll miss some gumbo. All you eating is garbage. That's all you're eating. and then turn around and holler about, well we want some we gonna have some chitlings for Sunday, and here you are. You walk in your house and smell that funk. It will run anybody out that has any common sense. But you go in there and you smell that funk. You smell that shit that's cooking. And you say, I can't wait for those chitlins to get done. How stupid. And they got all these other old names for them. Kentucky oysters. So I forget all the other names. But here you are. You're eating the waste track. Okay? And you're going to talk about you got some Kentucky oysters or some chitlins. No, you have shitlings. You're literally eating shit. You're eating the shit track. And then talk about it's good. I mean, my sisters and brothers, Western civilization, they have fucked us up. I mean, they have passed down this bullshit to us and gave us the last part of the cow that comes across the fence from the beginning and still giving it to us. And we just eat it. I mean, just eat up like it's something good. I mean, I am so fed up with the bullshit. I mean, I can't see how. I mean, in this day and age, everybody should be awake. Who's going to wake up? Now, let's go a little further here. Let's look at what he says here. Verse 4, he says, then we assemble unto me everyone that tremble at the word of the God of Israel, because of the transgressions of those that had been carried away, and set a stone unto the eating sacrifice. I mean, he said that I can't believe. I mean, he just sat down. I mean, and just wept, you know, because of this great trespass that the people had done did. Not only that, Levi was in it too, and the princes. Levi was in it. But anyway, let's go a little further here. He says, verse 5 says, and at evening, verse 5, he says, and at the evening sacrifice I arose up from my heaviness, and having rent my garment and my mantle, I fell upon my knees and spread out my hand unto the Lord my God, and said, oh my God, I am ashamed, I am blushed to lift up my face unto my God, for our iniquity are increased over our heads, and our trespass is grown up unto heaven. He says, I'm up to hearing it. I'm up over my head in this bullshit. And here we are today. We just love our enemy. We just love our enemy. And then say all kind of old foolish ass shit. You know, well, we got a pretty baby. So that mean that you're ugly? I mean, Western civilization have beat your ass down until you have even convinced yourself that you're not attractive because you're black and you want to be white. I tell you, it is so frustrating. But anyway, look what he says here. He says, since the days of our father, verse 7, have we been in great trespass unto this day, and for our iniquity have we, our kings and our prince, been delivered into the hands of the kings of this land, to the sword, to captivity, and to spoil, and to confusion of face as it is this day. That's why you call him Raven Simone Black, because you got confusion of face. I mean, I just look around now, and the Most High have bought us almost to naught now. I mean, honestly, you just look around and you see the mixing and the mingled all around you. I mean, it is nothing but a few of us. We are the remnant. There's not many of us left. If you just look around, there is not many of us left, my sisters and brothers. The Most High has to come back. Elijah has to be on his way. This is the last hour. There is no doubt in my mind. I know for a fact. Jeremiah said in the last days they're going to be calling right wrong and wrong right. I mean, they're fucking colorblind. Here's a person that looks damn near white and you hollering about they're black. Like everyone on this damn show called Empire. Those are master's children. He just won't accept them. Those are his children. They are not black. They don't look anything like a black person. But yet and still, you will accept. Well, you wanna be like them. But let me tell you something. If you're black and you're Hebrew, you will never be like them. Never, not in this lifetime. I can guarantee you that. You will never be successful. Why? Because God got his hand on you. God has you under a curse. You can't prosper. You may have a little something here or there, but you will never have the millions that they have. Never! You will never see those days. Now, if you are master's child, the one that is mingled, absolutely. Because it is their time now. It was master's time. Now it's master's children time. And then the end is going to come. And we're going to come back to the top. That's the way it's written. And that's the way it's going to be. Now, let's go a little further here. But we get an idea. I want you to finish reading Ezra 9. And you will see that God's called this an abomination. For you to mingle your seed with any other nation but your people. Now let's go to Proverbs. Let's look at that. Proverbs 20. Let's look at Proverbs 20. Well, 22. Proverbs 22. Let's look at verse 11. It says, "He that loveth pureness of heart, for the grace of his lips, the king shall be his friend. The eye of the Lord preserveth knowledge, and he overthroweth the words of the transgression. The slothful man saith, there is a lion without. I shall be slain in the streets. The mouth of strange woman is a deep pit. He that is abhorred of the Lord shall fall therein." So, in other words, you married to a mingle and you are a Hebrew. God said, "I abhor you. I don't like you. As a matter of fact, I hate you. I hate you enough that I will not allow you to make me a holy seed." That's right. It's right in the pages. So while you strutting around like a fucking peacock, thinking that you got the cream of the crop, and here you are, you strutting around with the scum of the earth. God says he abhors you. That's right. What do you think about that now? Let's go to the book of Leviticus. Let's go there. Leviticus. Let's go to the book of Leviticus. Leviticus, the 20th chapter. Let's go there. Leviticus 20. See, because we need to see this, my sisters and brothers. We need to realize that God does not like for us. He hates it when we mingle with other nations. God wants a pure people, and that's all he's going to accept. Nothing more and nothing less. If you're not Hebrew, you're not his. If you have been mingled with anything else, you're not Hebrew. I don't give a damn what you could be black as coal, blacker than I am. You are not Hebrew. It is about your bloodline. If your bloodline is not pure, believe me, you're not Hebrew. I don't give a damn what you want to, or what you're hoping to, or what you're praying. All those things are obsolete. Now let's look at Leviticus here 20, chapter 20. And let's look at verses 22 down to 26. Look what it says. "You should therefore keep all my statutes and all my judgments and do them, that the land whether I bring you to dwell therein spew you not out. and ye shall not walk in the manner of the nations which I cast out before you, for they commit all these things, and therefore I abhor them. But I have said unto you, ye shall inherit their land, and I will give it unto you to possess it, a land that floweth with milk and honey. I am the Lord your God, which have separated you from other people. I mean, how in the hell can anyone not understand that? Separation means that you over here and I'm over here. God says, I have separated you from all the people. But yet, and still here in America, we all are alike. You get up every morning, look in the damn mirror, and you see that your face is black as mine. Then you walk out your house and then look at a white person, one of the master's children, and say that we're all the same. How can that be? But anyway, let's go forward. Verse 24, he said, but I have said unto you, ye shall inherit their land, and I will give it unto you to possess it, a land that floweth with milk and honey. I am the Lord your God, which have separated you from other people. Ye shall therefore put, he's telling you, you should therefore put difference between clean beasts and unclean, and between clean fowls and clean unclean fowls. And ye shall not make your souls abominable by beasts, or by fowls, or by any manner of living thing that creepeth up on the ground, which I have separated you from you as unclean. He says, and ye shall be holy unto me. I the Lord am holy, and have saved you from other people, that you should be mine. I mean, how can we not see that God is saying, I want you to be separated? But yet and still, we still want to I want to be with them. Why? All you're doing is destroying yourself. Anytime, for right now, if I was to lay around with a white woman and say I marry her, which why I wouldn't marry one, neither lay around with one, even in a fucking nightmare. You know what I mean? But anyway, I'm using this as an example. Think about this. She and I have kids, all right? And I don't never come back to my heritage, to my black queen, all right? I just committed suicide. I just killed myself. You know why? Because I can't produce myself with her. The only one that I can produce myself with is one that looks like me. That's the only way. That's the only way. Now, let's go a little further. Let's go to the book of Deuteronomy. Watch this right here, my sisters and brothers. And watch this right here. 32. Deuteronomy 32. Let's look at verses 14, 15. Let's go on down to verse 19. All right, look what it says there. It says, butter of kin and milk of sheep with fat of lambs and rams of the breed of bear sheep and goats with the fat of kidneys with wheat. And thou didst drink the pure blood of the grapes. Good stuff. But Jeshurun waxed fat and thick. Thou art waxed fat. Thou art grown thick. Thou art covered with fatness. Then he forsook God, which made him, and lightly esteemed the rock of his salvation. They provoke him to jealousy with strange gods, with abomination provoke they him to anger. They sacrifice unto devils, not to God. Now, I'm going to say something here for just a moment here. They sacrifice unto devils. with an S, right? Now, where is the devil? But over the New Testament, all you see is the devils, and then you got demons, you know, in this right now. But here he's talking about the devils with a small G. But over the New Testament, the devil is, oh, he is mighty. Oh, he got all his power. But over here, he's a small god. He ain't shit. Two new gods, verse 17, that came newly up, whom your fathers fear not. See, there's no fear in no damn devils. But over the New Testament, they got a scare tactic where the devil is bad or the devil is this. The devil ain't shit. The devils ain't shit, neither is the devil. Okay, got that? I mean, I'm here to stress it because the devil ain't shit. The Most High, he is the ruler. Okay? So don't let nobody use no scare tactics on you talking about the devil this, the devil that, and Lucifer this, and Satan. No, Satan only does what God say do. Satan is working for God. The only one that said that he was going to come against God is Lucifer, the morning star. That's the one. But y'all know the story. He got kicked out. Now, let's go a little further here. This is for these Christians here. He says, verse 18, he says, of the rock that begat thee, thou art unmindful and hast forgotten God that formed thee. And when the Lord saw it, he abhorred them because of the provoking of his sons and of his daughters. See that? And he said, I will hide my face from them. I will set what their end shall be. For they are a very forward generation. See that? Israel was a forward generation. They didn't believe fat meat is greasy. That's what they said back in the olden days. But my sister and brother, it's right here in the pages. Now, we're going to go a little further here. Let us jump down here to, let's go to Ezekiel, let's go to Ezekiel. Ezekiel 30. Alright, let's go there. Now watch it, my sisters and brothers. Ezekiel 30. Come on here. We'll get it. Ezekiel 30. Let's look at verse 5 here. Now watch it, my brother. He says, Ethiopia and Libya and Lydia and all the mingled people of Cush and the men of the land that is in Lagos shall fall with them by the sword. Now that's what the Most High said about the mingles. He said they're going to fall by the sword. I mean, my sister and brother, I can go on and on through here, you know, and just show different scenarios and then show different scriptures where he tells us that we should not mingle his seed and that he doesn't care anything about the mingles. They're having their time now. But anyway, let's look at something else. Let's go to Nehemiah. Nehemiah, let's go there. Watch this right here. Nehemiah chapter 13. Now let's look at a couple of verses out of here. Let's look at verses 1, 2, and 3. Look what it says here. It says, on that day they read in the book of Moses in the audience of all the people, and therein was found written that the Amorites and the Moabites should not come into the congregation of God forever. See that? Because they met not the children of Israel with bread and with water, but hired Balaam against them that he should curse them. Howbeit, our God returned the curse into a blessing. See that? Now it came to pass, when they had heard the law, that they separated themselves from Israel, all the mixed multitude. Huh? See that? See that? They separated themselves from the mixed multitude. God does not want us to be mingled up with any other people but our own. I mean, but we think that, well, that was back then. No. Because he says Jacob is his inheritance. Nobody else. No one else but Jacob. But look what he says. It goes on here now. He says, and before this, Eliashib, the priest, having the oversight of the cherubim of the house of our God, was alien unto Tubaha, and he had prepared for him a great cherubim, a great chamber, where after time they laid and meat offering, the frankincense, and the vessels of tithes, of corn, new wine, and oil. Now you Christians, y'all going up every Sunday giving all your money to this man. And now you see what tithes are. See what tithes are? It's not money. Look what it says that the tithes were. It says of corn, new wine, and the oil, which was command to be given to Levi, the priest, huh? And the signage of the porter and of the offering of the priest. Now, I don't know why y'all give your money to this pastor, so-called, that's behind this code, this so-called sacred desk. I mean, it's right in the pages, my sister and brother. If you read Malachi, he said that it would be meat, M-E-A-T, not M-O-N-E-Y. I mean, but you have been told that meat means money. No, meat means meat. They had to burn meat on the altar. They're not burning any money. It was the meat. But anyway, that's for you Christians. Now, let's go a little further here. I want to show you guys something here. Let's go to Malachi. Let's go to Malachi here real quick. Watch it, my sister and brother. Now, we're going to read this real quick. Malachi chapter 2. And we're going to read real quick here. And look what it says here. It says, and now, O ye priests, okay, talking about Levi now, he said, this commandment is for you. If ye will not hear, and if ye will not lay it to heart, to give glory unto my name, saith the Lord of hosts, I will even send a curse upon you, and I will curse your blessing. I have cursed them already, because ye do not lay it to heart. Behold, I will corrupt your seed and spread dung upon your faces, even the dung of your solemn feast, and one shall take you away with it. See that? God saying, I'm going to spread shit all over your face, and then one going to take you away captive. God is ticked off with Levi. That's why this is a tag along off of Isaiah 53, because many thought that was Jesus, but no, he's talking about Levi. See, Levi was the one that had the law in his mouth, and Levi was the one that's supposed to give the law to Israel, but Levi got slack and lackadaisical, and didn't want to do his own thing, and then God had to punish his ass. But anyway, let's read verse 4. He said, and ye shall know that I have sent this commandment unto you, that my covenant might be with Levi, saith the Lord of hosts. My covenant with him. Remember me telling you in Isaiah 50:53 that when he talks about him and he's talking about Levi, not Jesus. He says, with him of life and peace. Levi, not Jesus. And gave them to him. Who? Levi. For the fear wherewith he who Levi feared me and was afraid before my name. Levi, not Jesus. The law of truth was in his mouth. Who? Levi. Look what he says here. And iniquity was not found in his lips. Who? Levi. He walked with me in peace and equality, and did not turn, and did turn many unto righteousness. Who are you talking about? Levi. He said, for the priest's lips should keep knowledge, and they should seek law at his mouth. Who? His Levi. For he who Levi is the messenger of the law, not Jesus. Not Jesus. Levi is right down, it's right in the pages. It goes on. But anyway, I don't want to go too far because I don't want to go over my 40. But look what he says here. He says here in verse 8, he says, But ye are departed out of the way. Ye have caused many to stumble at the law. Why? Who are you talking about? Levi. Because the law was in whose mouth? Levi. He said, ye have corrupt the covenant of Levi, saith the Lord of hosts. Therefore have I also made you contemptible and base. Brought you down. See that? Before all the people according to you, as ye have not kept my ways, but have been partial in the law. Have we not all one Father? Hath not one God created us? Why do we deal treacherously, even at every man against his brother, by profaning the covenant of our father? Judah has dealt treacherously, and an abomination is committed in Israel and in Jerusalem. For Judah hath profaned the holiness of the law which he loved, and has married the daughter of a strange God. Y'all see that? Let's read again. Verse 11, he said, Judah has dealt treacherously, and an abomination is committed in Israel and in Jerusalem. For Judah has profaned the holiness of the law which he loved, and has married the daughter of a strange God. God does not appreciate that. God does not want that. I don't give a damn what they want to say here in America. I don't care what nobody else tells you. God wants his bloodline to be pure. He does not want you. He said that it is an abomination for you to marry outside your race. And you think just because a woman or a man has a little color in them that you marry them, that they're black. That's not true. That's not true at all. They got to have the Hebrew bloodline in order to be Hebrew. Male and female. So my sisters and brothers, we see here that God does not want his children to mingle his seed. I don't care what everyone else is doing. I don't care about that. All I care about is my sisters and brothers. All I care about is the Hebrew Israelites. Nobody else. I don't give a damn what nobody else does. All my communication is to my sisters and brothers. All my trying to persuade is my sisters and brothers. All my warning is to my sisters and brothers. All my love is to my sisters and brothers. I don't give a damn about nobody else. I don't. That's not my concern. That's not my business. My business is you, Israel, no one else. So when I come on here, all my complaints and all my arguments is with my people, no one else. Why? Because he told me to warn Israel, nobody else. He didn't tell me to warn the white man. He didn't tell me to warn the Chinese. See, when God says that when you marry a strange flesh, he's talking about Chinese, Mexicans. Yes, yes. The light-skinned Mexicans, yes, yes. He's talking about Korean, Japanese. He's talking about all of these white people that are all over the world. That's who he's talking about. And the ones that has color in their skin and they're not Hebrew, he's talking about them too. I guarantee you, You can go over to England right now. If your life depended on it, or the Queen's life depended on it, the Queen of England would say, kill me, because she would not allow one of her sons to marry anything that looks like me. Or they could be light-skinned. She would say, kill me, because they want their bloodline to stay pure. I mean, every other nations, a black man, he doesn't have to be Hebrew. He can just be dark-skinned, and he can go and lay with a Chinese woman, and they may even have a child. You know that the Chinese nation will say, that baby ain't Chinese. They will. It's not Chinese. But then they'll throw it to us. You know what I mean? Well, that's a black child. No, it's not. It's not no black child. That child is mingled. That child is mixed. He's not black. He or she, whatever it may be. But my sisters and brothers, we have to learn to love ourselves and stop taking any bullshit that they throw out there to us. If it's not the real deal, it's not part of us. It's not one of us. Stop saying that everyone that has a little color in them, especially the one that don't have any color in them, they're not black. I mean, our identity is being stolen time after time, and I'm tired of it. Wanna holler about it? I'm black, I'm black, I'm black. You may have some color in you, but you're not Hebrew. My sisters and brothers, we here at LightOfMeaningOne.org. We wish all of our sisters and brothers a happy Sabbath. Until next time, shalom.